This is Michael Wilton from Queensrÿche, and you're listening to Sonic Perspectives.
Welcome to another interview for your favorite online magazine, Sonic Perspectives. My name is Joel Barrios, and today I have the pleasure of being backstage at Culture Room in Fort Lauderdale, where Queensrÿche is beginning their North American headlining tour, John 5. Joining me here is none other than Michael Wilton, guitarist and founding member of this legendary rock band. It's an absolute pleasure to have you here with us today, Michael.
Thank you very much, and we're very happy to be here. Again.
Yes. Let's start off by congratulating you for your two just announced events for Queensrÿche, the opening slot for Scorpion in their upcoming July Las Vegas residency, and the band's inclusion in the Rockfest 2020 lineup, also happening in July in Wisconsin.
Yes. You know, Queensrÿche is very busy on this tour. The Verdict Tour is taking us all over the globe. And we're getting lots of offers for other countries. We really wanted to, you know, spend maybe a couple of years and then try and get some writing going, you know, for writing new material for the next album. We'll be able to tour off this probably for two and a half, maybe 3 years.
Yeah, you've been touring relentlessly, and you've also been pretty much holding the opening band slot for Scorpions for quite a number of years. I remember traveling from my hometown here in Miami to Ohio back in 2015 to catch you guys there opening for them. And whenever I haven't seen you headlining, I've seen you opening for Scorpion. So can you remember how did you guys get invited the first time? And what would you say is the reason that they keep bringing you along for the ride?
Well, I think it's actually a good mix of music. You know, I think our music complements the Scorpions' music, and it's just a smooth transition. We get along; they like us, obviously, and we respect their tour, and we know it's their tour. So, we're fast; we get off the stage fast, and we get out of their way. We've developed this relationship, and it's great, to consider them friends and for them to consider us for tours and special events like this residency.
Yeah, I mean, I would say probably the Scorpions audience is not 100% familiar with your music, and the fact that you're opening for them also opens your music to new audiences and new people that maybe were not familiar at the time.
Exactly, and that's what, you know, they give us a 50-minute set, maybe sometimes a 60-minute set, and we try and do a balance of the classics.
The old and the new.
And for the most part, their fans know our classics, which is great. So, we hit them with some new stuff, and hopefully we can get some of their audience to start listening to
us. Sure thing. You were touching on the subject of like touring endlessly, and also in that regard, you were invited to the Chris Cruise 10 in October, and last year you also participated in the first edition of the Mega Cruise, mm-hmm. and in the Monster of Rock Cruise, which you've been playing numerous times. Mm-hmm. These three events relate to three different genres of rock and roll, yet Queensrÿche seems to be appreciated as a band that fits in them all. What would you say is the reason for your music to be accepted for those dissimilar audiences?
Well, I think, for the most part, I mean, we're more of a heavy power rock, power metal band, but, you know, we're melodic. And I think our music is somewhat unique to itself, that it can fit in on a Scorpions tour and it can fit on a mega cruise, you know, with heavier bands. You know, there's elements of Queensrÿche that fit with all audiences. And I think that's why we do these tours. You know, it's just the fact that we've done progressive cruises, mm-hmm. you know, and we're very noticed in the progressive side of music, mm-hmm. but we're also, you know, very melodic, and, you know, we write songs, and that's what people want to hear.
And when you need to rock out, you rock out as well.
Sure. It's all part of the deal.
Exactly.
It's the name of the game.
Uh-huh. Going back to The Verdict, the album has been met with unanimous praise from critics and fans alike. To support it, you've been touring, as you said, relentlessly, and you still are, and you will be. I saw you guys in this very same venue last year, and you have a terrific visual presentation, including some fantastic videos put together by my friend Dave Stably. Given all that level of sophistication now in your shows, have you thought, discussed, or even planned an official live release, which will also become the first live document with Todd as a singer?
There's a possibility. You know, we do have a lot of recordings of all the shows that we've done. So I know that is very much a possibility, audio only, you know. But, you know, we could always do something in the making. Kind of all depends, you know, our scheduling and what the record company wants. And we have many, many songs recorded live that we could release. And I know it's just a matter of figuring it all out, you know. There's a lot of things that you have to do to get access and use them for live recordings.
Yeah, I bet. So with the impact of such a grueling tour album cycle for you as a guitarist, is there any kind of routine you go about regarding your playing skills and physical shape when you're traveling?
Yeah, we try and you know, be healthy when we're eating, and some of us work out, go to, you know, gyms and fitness places. We're fans of music, so we want to keep our...
That propels you.
Our A game, basically. And we want to, you know, always be musically proficient, you know. And so I think that's what drives us, you know, because we just have a desire for that.
Right on. What would you say, Michael, that resonates with you the most from the last album, either in a style or in lyrical content?
Well, for me, it's all about having a group of guys that get along, that are willing to take musical chances and to not be intimidated, but to input their creativity and to build that and meld that into a Queensrÿche song, you know? And that's, to me, that's what's fun about being in a band. When everybody's contributing and you don't know the outcome, you know, songs can go one way or the other, and it's always really interesting to see the end result.
Well, that's quite an statement there. Do you feel that somehow you're still defined by what many would call your classic era, or you seem that you've successfully transformed the Queensrÿche image for the 21st century?
Well, obviously, there's no denying our past, and you know, we're going to be played on classic radio just because of those hits, right? So it's, but you know, we take it all in. It's all good for us, you know. But it's great that when rock radio stations are playing the new music as well. So, and the fact that we are putting out new music and touring on it enables us to tour different parts of the world, and to get on tours and to do festivals, and to be keeping the fans interested in us. And I know there's a lot of bands that just tour on their past and never put out new music, but we're the opposite. We want to keep evolving Queensrÿche.
That's exactly what the fans want to hear.
And, you know, and we're having a fun time doing it.
That's what matters the most. There's been a lot of controversy around the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame choices for this year, the omission of Judas Priest and Motorhead, just to name a couple of bands. And many have expressed that there is a need for them to refocus. What's your point of view about that? And do you expect Queensrÿche to be nominated or inducted anytime soon in the future? Or you don't care?
I don't have a point of view on that. I think it's, you know, it's in the hands of somebody else, you know. So I don't think it's a, you know, a broad spectrum of input of fans, and I think it's all a close-knit group of people that kind of figure it out, so I'm not really interested in
it. So you pretty much are okay with whatever happens?
Yep. They can have themselves.
Yeah. Where would you say that you are at the moment in terms of composing or maybe shaping in any form or any way the possible follow-up for the verdict? Have you put any ideas together?
Right now, it's all just ideas. It's all just guitar riffs. So we have a lot of work ahead of us, a lot of creativity that has to be built. And this tour, is going to allow us to come up with lots of ideas. And we'll keep working at it. And hopefully we'll have something by the end of the year that we can present to the record company. But I'm not promising anything, though.
No, of course. I mean, if I get the idea correctly, you're trying to ride on the momentum of this new album and just really tour, and along the way, something will come up.
That's kind of the cycle that we're in. And it's write a record, put it out, tour on it for 3 years, and then write another record and keep doing that. And then, you know, along the way, there's possibilities, but maybe we can release something of, you know, a live album. But right now, it's the second half of the tour.
Exactly.
Starting here and
starting tonight. Exactly.
In Florida.
Uh-huh. How do you say that you determine what songs to be included in your set list? And what can the fans expect from the tour that starts here tonight?
You know, it's more about a flow. You know, with our set list, obviously there's going to be songs that you're always going to have to play. And it's about bringing back some of the obscure songs and then representing a couple new songs from the verdict. So I think everybody's going to like this set list, and the whole show is going to be very visual, and it's going to be very powerful.
Well, keeping the A game is what you said, right?
That's right.
You guys do a lot of interviews. I'm sure you hear a lot of the same questions time and time again. So what is the answer to a question that you've never been asked before? Or to put it in a different way, what's a question you've never been asked but you would like to elaborate on? Kind of tricky one, right? I'm pretty sure you've been asked almost everything.
I think one thing, you know, the fans don't realize is that we're doing so many shows per week, you know, week on end. And, you know, we get sick, we get tired.
You're humans.
And we still put on a show. They don't see what we're going through. And it's not like we want to advertise it either, but that's something, we'll put on a great show no matter what. And, you know, they don't realize sometimes that some of us are sick or hurting or burned out. And I think that goes unnoticed.
Yeah, it definitely goes unnoticed. I mean, it's grueling, as I said before. If I were to ask you how you define risk and ambition for you personally as an artist and for the band, what would you say that is in this well-developed career of yours?
I think it's all about taking chances. It's all about pushing the envelope and just enjoying the whole creative process. But yeah, we're always pushing ourselves. And to do that, you know, sometimes it is taking risks because you have no idea how the fan is going to perceive your music.
And you're totally right.
And that's always been Queensryche's motto. We just evolve. And, you know, in doing so, you take chances.
While keeping your core nature, the one that you've been bringing with you throughout decades right now, what kind of music Michael Wilton listens to on a daily basis? And what kind of albums impress you recently?
I really don't listen to... I listen to, like, in the morning, I'll turn on classical music.
Classical music? Wow,
yeah.
That's surprising.
I'll listen... I'll tell Google to shuffle Andre Segovia, Christopher Parkening, or more of a jazzy guitar player, Ralph Towner. And I'll drink some coffee. And that's about the only music I really listen to.
I'm pretty sure our listeners are going to love this part. So let's grab it up with five short facts about you. Where's home?
Seattle, Washington.
Favorite music venue?
Wow. There's so many. I don't have a favorite.
Surprising fact about you that nobody knows about?
That I'm a pretty good golfer.
What do you collect?
I collect guitars.
Yeah, I would be surprised to hear something else. Last one, favorite piece of technology?
Wow, my Kemper amp.
Okay, do you want to elaborate a little bit about that?
Yeah, it's a rack mount music processor that I've been using for 3 years, and because we travel a lot, you know, I can put it in a Pelican case and have the same sound every night. It sounds amazing. It profiles your old amps and saves it in it, and it replicates it, you know, exactly. And it's the best piece of technology that's, in my opinion, that's come out in a long time.
I know. Sounds like a lifesaver for you.
It is. It is.
So, Michael, we close each interview by playing a song of the band's most recent effort. What song would you like us to play at the end of this chat?
How about from the Verdict, Inner Unrest?
Excellent choice. Michael, it's been an absolute pleasure to have you here with us at Sonic Perspective. We selected The Verdict as one of the most important progressive metal albums of 2019, and we consider it a beyond stellar manifesto of a band that is at the peak of its powers.
Wow, thank you very much.
And I said that not only as a compliment, but as a reality. Thank you for your time, and we wish you and the whole Queensrÿche camp the absolute best in the tour and in any future endeavors.
Thank you. Thanks for having
me. Thanks to you.
Enjoy the show tonight.
We will.